students all over the South started sitting in at lunch counters. And I knew that as they were sitting in, they were really standing up for the best in the American dream.
On February 1st, 1960, four African-American college students participated in what is known as the Greensboro sit-ins. The students demonstrated the power and impact that nonverbal and symbolic communication can have as they use nonviolent protests to communicate a powerful message of courage while exposing racism. This subsequently impacted the ongoing civil rights movement as thousands throughout the South joined in nonviolent direct action protest. In 1868, the 14th Amendment gave black people equal protection under the law. Still, many white Americans considered blacks to be inferior. As a result, they marginalized black people and tried to erase the progress they had made from the Constitutional Amendment. In the South, they did this by establishing Jim Crow laws. These laws prevented African Americans from using the same public facilities, going to the same schools, and living in the same towns as white people. Additionally, Southern segregation was legalized in 1896 when the U.S. Supreme Court declared in Plessy v. Ferguson that facilities for black and white people could be separate but equal. Yet even with these setbacks, blacks created many organizations to end race-based discrimination, one of which was the NAACP, who fought for equality through the legal system. With their help, the civil rights movement began in 1954, as African Americans across the U.S. struggled to gain equal rights. One case was brought on behalf of Linda Brown, a third grader from Topeka, Kansas. Several additional school segregation cases were combined into one, known as Brown v. Board of Education. This case reached the Supreme Court in 1953. But it wasn't until 1955 that the injustice and violence that was commonplace in the South was exposed through the tragedy of Emmett Till. The rapid spread of television brought severe images of racism into the living room, drawing national attention and striking fear and outrage. By the late 1950s, dissenting voices gained a new platform through the media. Rosa Parks' refusal to give up her seat on the bus led to the Montgomery bus boycott, and other events such as the desegregation of Central High School in Little Rock, Arkansas, were all early examples of change that inspired the African-American community to take pride in their ethnicity and challenge the system. However, after the success of the Montgomery bus boycott, the civil rights movement was at a standstill. The use of violence from white segregationists communicated a warning to African Americans that scared them into silence. Progress wasn't taking place, and there was a need for direct action. During the Civil Rights Movement, Martin Luther King Jr.'s belief in utilizing nonviolent protests against racial discrimination led him to India, as he was inspired by the teaching of Mahatma Gandhi. MLK left India with the idea that
organized nonviolent resistance is the most powerful weapon that oppressed people can use in breaking loose from the bondage of oppression.
MLK's nonviolent protest technique inspired young African Americans all over the nation, including four students who attended North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University: Azelle Blair Jr., later known as Jabril Kazan, Franklin McLean, Joseph McNeil, and David Richmond. After coming back from a trip to New York, Joseph McNeil was denied service at a bus depot. The stark difference between his treatment in New York and North Carolina angered McNeil, and he knew he had to take action. Each of the four had individual motivations to protest, but ultimately the decision came to act once they found each other. The four of them planned their nonviolent protests carefully. These four students specifically targeted the segregational policy in F.W. Woolworth's company, which prohibited blacks from sitting and eating at the lunch counter. On the afternoon of February 1st, 1960, in Greensboro, North Carolina, Blair Jr., Richmond, McCain, and McNeil entered their local Woolworth's department store and purchased a notebook to prove they were paying customers. After walking around the store, they mustered the courage to sit down at the white-only lunch counter. Their orders were denied by waitstaff, but the four refused to move until closing. The lunch counter manager had already alerted the police, but they could do nothing as the four men were paying customers and had not taken any violent actions. When the lunch counter closed, the four men promised they would be back. News spread fast of the sit-ins, and even before the students arrived on the second day, media outlets had already gathered outside Woolworth's, including photographers, news stations, and reporters from UPI and AP News. The Greensboro Four returned to protest with an additional 20 students. They again were refused service, and Woolworth's closed early. Within the following week, the sit-ins spread throughout the community. Approximately 1,400 students from surrounding colleges came to protest at Woolworth's. Students from North Carolina A&T University, Bennett's Women's College, and Dudley High School descended upon the downtown area. On the third day, the opposition showed up. Pressure mounted as protesters converged upon the city's business district and were met by angry white crowds who called the protesters names, waved Confederate flags, and threatened violence. The organizers expanded the sit-in protest to other lunch counters, including the SH Crescent Co., bringing downtown Greensboro to a virtual standstill. As tension grew, the environment became more hostile. Saturday night, both Woolworths and the close-by stores were forced to close due to bombs. scares. The simple act of sitting down to eat turned out to be the catalyst that ignited a decade of revolt. The students had discovered the power of direct action protest. Their energy and example spread to 54 cities in 9 states, across the Upper South and into the North, where young people joined in various forms of peaceful protests against segregation in libraries, beaches, hotels, and other establishments. The Greensboro sit-ins were a pivotal moment that galvanized students across America to communicate their opinions against segregation. In other cities where sit-ins occurred, there was violent backlash from white agitators. White customers at the Woolworths in Nashville physically attacked the protesters as they pulled them out of their seats. Although they were being harassed, the protesters did not fight back and continued to peacefully protest. In Jacksonville, Florida, participants were beat with axe handles and baseball bats. In spite of the verbal abuse, assault, and violence from the white segregationists, the student activists remained undeterred in their use of organized nonviolence to spread their message, only showing their strength and perseverance. And on July 5th, 1960, Woolworth desegregated its lunch counter throughout the South. The fundamental contribution of the sit-ins was to provide a new medium for how protest could be expressed.
The sit-ins are speaking a new language in a dramatic and graphic way that leads to a very, very different kind of response by a whole generation.
The sit-ins represented a new language and gave a generation the opportunity to rise. Sit-ins conveyed the message in a manner people could not possibly ignore. Thousands of people sitting with dignity at a lunch counter demanding their rights.
This action in Greensboro that really was the, you know, it was the flame that really just spread and really helped to galvanize folks across the South and across the country.
The peaceful sit-in movement destroyed the harmful stereotypes about blacks that white segregationists commonly used to support the Jim Crow system. Through the symbolic nonviolent communication, protesters were able to provide a new perspective about African Americans and open up a conversation in society about segregation. The newfound student activism led to the development of the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, or SNCC, which was primarily made up of young college-age African American students. SNCC's coordination of the Freedom Rides and the marches and sit-ins led by MLK in Birmingham brought the debate to a federal level. Their power and strength during the protests in Birmingham prompted President John F. Kennedy to call for legislation that said,
"It ought to be possible for American consumers of any color to receive equal service in places of public accommodation, such as hotels and restaurants and theaters and retail stores, without being forced to resort to demonstrations in the street."
The sit-ins did not bring final victory to the black community, but they became the new language of the civil rights movement. In the first few decades following the events of February 1st, the people of Greensboro did little to acknowledge the sit-in's significance. But finally in 1990, a February 1 monument dedicated to the brave Greensboro Four was constructed and still stands at North Carolina A&T University. Organizers sent pieces of the lunch counter to the International Civil Rights Center and Museum, the National Museum of African American History and Culture, and a four-set portion of the lunch counter was donated to the Smithsonian Institution and is displayed at the National Museum of American History. The Greensboro events had a lasting impact, not only on the southern states, but also on the nation. February 1st demonstrates the effectiveness of symbolic and nonviolent speech throughout history. By strategically communicating their desire to change the law, in spite of the white agitators, the students were able to draw attention to their cause and communicate their frustration towards their lack of freedom and justice in society. By doing this, the students taught us that in order to communicate our ideas, we must do so in a language that cannot be ignored. The powerful use of symbolic and nonviolent protests has been seen throughout history. This has recently come to light during the Black Lives Matter protests of 2020, when the deaths of Ahmaud Arbery, Breonna Taylor, and George Floyd sparked national outrage. Protests occurred in 140 cities across the United States. Although the important message of ending police brutality, discrimination, and systematic racism towards black people was communicated, protests in some cities turned violent as civil unrest heightened. Police stations were set on fire, and rioting and looting of businesses occurred. According to an ACLED statistic, only 7% of protests were violent, the rest remaining peaceful and utilizing similar protest techniques to those used in the 1960s. However, even with the small percent, people discredited the impact and importance of the entire Black Lives Matter movement. Demonstrating nonviolent symbolic protests allows one to communicate their message without the meaning being lost. It is important to recognize that by using nonviolent symbolic communication, it is possible to inspire others and create meaningful change without undermining or impeding the importance of the message. For the brave Greensboro Four taught us how to stand up by sitting down.